Welcome back to Let's Interactively Play. Steve Jackson Sorcery. I am the RPG Chick, and this is a Let's Play where you get to decide at the end what turn we're going to take next in the story. So, where are we? You place your foot on the first step of the stairwell, and suddenly it begins to move. Is it alive? Some sort of thin, flat beast? Or is it a trap? Last episode, all two of you said to grab the handrail. So I will do so now. You grab the handrail to steady yourself, only to find it is moving as well. hold on. You cling onto the rail to keep yourself upright. It seems the rail is moving at the same speed as the step underneath you. You rise to the top of the stairwell in a smooth motion and jump off in perfect safety. Don't let the alligators get you. All right, well, we got up there. You look around. You're on an upstairs landing with doors on either side. So you really, We got magical escalators. I love books. Let's go to the library. It seems promising. This is a library in darkness. At the far end, a pair of eyes stare back at you. People there, or jewels glimmering for us to take? But look at the eyes. You step forward boldly, your own eyes fixed on those across the room from you. They do not blink. They do not even move as you approach. Stare it out. You stop and try to stare the creature out. It is agonizing work. A minute goes by and still neither of you have blinked. Am I going to lose stamina from this? You keep staring until your eyes begin to ache. The eyes do not react. Then you see why. They are the eyes of a large portrait that hangs over the far wall in shadow, but for a dim sunbeam falling through a gap in the roof above. We just had a staring contest with a painting. Let's check out this painting. You won the contest, painting. It is of a proud and stern-looking man, dressed in loose leather armor with a serpent emblem stitched along the length of one arm. The painting fills the entire wall of the room and must be twice the height of the man who posed for the likeness. Look at him. Definitely gonna look behind it as well. You step back a little to regard the man in the picture. The most striking thing about him are his eyes. Cold and cruel, they seem to gleam with cunning and the will to survive. They are the eyes of a man who would harm you if it suited him, knowing full well what it was he did. Otherwise, he stands tall and proud, with one hand on the hilt of a sword and the other wielding a tiny dagger. Everything about him reeks of power and threat. He's a well-armed man. The picture must be of the man that lived in this house. For anyone else, it would surely cast too long a shadow to live beneath. The eyes of the painting seem to follow you as you move. Look behind the painting. You raise one corner of the frame from the wall and peer up behind it, but it is too dark to see if there is anything hidden there. Lift the painting down, or take the painting down. You grab the base of the painting between outstretched hands, then heft the frame up and off the hook that holds it to the wall. There's a moment when you think you have it under control, then you are holding the true weight of the picture and begin to stagger backwards. Try to balance it. Oh, I lost stamina doing that, damn it. I just lost two stamina. You backpedal across the room, trying to keep your balance. The painting threatens to topple at any moment. If you can just get turned around, you'll be able to lean the painting against the wall. What's the difference? Step backwards. If I step backwards and to the right, we got this chair. Or the left, rather. If I step backwards, we got the fireplace. How big is this painting? Must be pretty big. What am I doing? Step backwards and to the left. Okay. The chair didn't even figure into it. You step backwards and to the left and bring the painting down to floor to rest safely against the opposite wall. You rub your arms with relief. Look at the end wall. You look over the wall where the painting had hung, but there was nothing else of interest, just its dark outline. Look at the back of the canvas. Why am I lifting paintings around and losing stamina? Is that who you're looking for? With the painting tilted against the side wall, you are able to slip around and look at the back of the canvas in the weak light that trickles in through the door. It is unremarkable, with just a single inscription near the middle of the canvas. Theta, seventh noble of Kharé. The painting looks like a noble, all right. Or at least it looks like the painting a noble would have had made of themselves. But even if this was once Theta's house, it looks like he has long since left. We need to find the spell line here. You turn your attention from the portrait. There's nothing else in the room. One clue and one clue updated. Theta, hmm? Get ready for some loud music. Oh, what am I doing? I want to go into items. Oh, Theta we found. I found his spell line even, and everything. Well, he's nothing like the guy in the portrait now. We're looking for Moulas. That's right. If I were a Moulas, where would I be? Can I go into the other room now? Do I have to return to the top of the stairs? Okay, bedroom. You step through a doorway into a simple bedroom. The bed is unmade and looks as though its owner left in a hurry. Personal effects are scattered all over the floor, as if the place had been ransacked, which it probably was. A cane leans by the bedside. You see nothing else of interest. Look at the cane. The cane is a simple straight stick with a leather loop at the top to slip around the wearer's wrist. It does not look like any sort of weapon, and it does not appear to be magic. Well, I'm going to take it. You take it, although you cannot think what it might be for. A second door leads further into the house, or you could return to the stairwell. Into the bathroom. Can I look at this some more? Walking cane, huh? I'm wondering if it has to do with this. There was some kind of mark or like a depression. If you put the cane in, maybe? Check the bathroom. The further door leads to a bathroom. There is nothing in it, not even a mirror, only a gap where one used to hang. The only fixture is an empty iron bathtub in the middle of the tiled floor. Look under the bathtub? You crouch down and peer under the bath. Something darts at your face and you leap back. Run my sword under the bath. Well, what leaped away? You draw your sword and swipe it in an arc underneath the bath. It comes away clean. No blood and no hidden treasure. You head out of the small room. So what the hell darted at my face? I'll never find out. Turn to the bedroom. You walk back out into the hall. There's nothing more to explore up here. I want to go back to the other room. You've turned down the stairs, which seem quite normal now. Back to the lower hall. There does not seem anything more here to be discovered. Ah, well, I'll be the judge of that. Thank you. You return to the study room. You creep back into the fireplace to the stone dead end where the grooves in the stonework radiate out from a small hole. The strange wall at the end of the hearth is just as you left it. You try to dig up something else that might fit the hole. Insert the walking cane. You raise the walking cane and slip the tip into a small hole in the back of the fireplace. It fits perfectly. There's a click. For a moment, nothing happens, and then very slowly the stones begin to move. A passageway has opened to your left. Awesome. Enter the passageway. You peer through the secret passage but can make out nothing but darkness beyond. You will have to go inside to find out what you have discovered. Well, that's fine. Inside, here we are. Slipping through the narrow opening, you find yourself in a slightly wider space. The walls are cool stone, and there are no windows. But the room is not dark. In one corner, an idol stands on a small shrine, lit by two candles which burn with thin, cold flames. This place reeks of death and decay. The shrine is covered in thin, blood-soaked strips of cloth. Blood-soaked strips of... Look at the cloth. The bandages are each an arm span across... I'm starting over. The bandages are each an arm span long and as deep as your thumb. Each is bloodied in two spaces, spaced a few fingers' widths apart. There are 30 or 40 such bandages here, running down from the shrine like streamers. Someone was injured for a long time. Search the bandages. Ooh. You sift through the pile of bloodied cloth straps quickly, stomach churning. Something gleams from within the pile, and you uncover a silver badge. It is the badge of a noble of Kharé. Take! The badge is solid silver and probably valuable to its owner should you encounter them. You place it carefully into your pack. You glance behind you, suddenly terrified that the secret door might swing shut and leave you trapped in this place. I hope not. Let's look at the shrine. That's what we're here for. The shrine is poor and cheap, unlike everything else in this house. It seems to have been hastily built out of uneven stones and a plank of wood, and the small statue of a fat god that sits on it has been molded from a humble clay. You're starting to get the jitters down here. So I've got a Buddha here. It must be some... Oh, another Korga. It must be some local deity. At the base of the statue is the name Korga. Above his head is a plaque with a short inscription, and on his face are painted four red dots. Read the inscription. The inscription is scrawled as though in the hand of a child. You have to squint to read it. Give me back my eyes. Look at the dots. The dots on the idol seem to have been daubed with a fingertip. There are perhaps directions on how to worship the god, but there is no indication of what to do, or in what order. Only the places, both eyes, the third eye in his forehead, and his mouth. Oh, this is directions on how to solve the temple in the other area by the north gate. There is nothing more to be seen in this terrible place. You slip back out of the small room, out of the fireplace, and into the hallway. Okay. First, before I do that, I want to look at this badge. I guess it's a key? Where's the badge? Oh, treasure. So now we have a treasure area, badge of the seventh noble. Huh. Can I sell that? And get gold? Yeah, same text as before, so... The house is home now only to ghosts. You hurry back out of the door into the sunshine of the front garden. Outside the house, the sun is shining brightly. It is almost the hottest hour of the day. Oh, you think there's anything to be found around here? Look at the fountain. You think I can get stamina back? Oh, I did. Three more. Yay! A fountain by the door is still bubbling. Cupping your hands, you drink a deep mouthful and feel much better. Yay! I love feeling much better. Let's go around the path. At the back? Oh. You follow the path around the back of the building. The rear is simply boarded up and secure, with no new ways in that you can see. There's a low stone wall, partially ruined, through which the path continues, turning into a track that runs away through fields. Okay. I don't think we've been over here, so why not follow the track? You follow the track, clambering over a fence, into a wide stretch of grazing land. A rocky bluff on the left-hand side throws the path into shadow. On the top of this rise is the bulk of Kharé, squatting like a gigantic toad. The fields themselves are on the lower plane. That's the festival. So we can go back to the front yard. Or keep going. You know what? I don't want to end up in the festival again, but... we haven't been on this road, have we? No. We ended up going... we first came into this accursed place. We came out here. Ended up going here. And I think we just headed this way. There, there. And then ended up in festival. So, we haven't seen this back road. So, I say we go this way. Guess I could, like, leave every video up to, you know, a decision, but we'd, you know, be playing this for, like, 10 years. You continue along the track, leaving the buildings of Lower Kharé behind. Since no one can leave the walls of Kharé, they do their farming here inside the walls as best they can. After walking a half an hour or so, the path meets a wide road. You hear a groaning sound from a nearby field, like someone was being cruelly hurt. Look for the noise. Half a dozen fat pigs are grubbing in the muck to the right. Just beyond them, a group of creatures huddle around a fire pit, from which there drifts a mouth-watering smell. Kharé seems to be filled with creatures you can't place, half one thing and half another, but from the way the strange creatures at the fire pit sit and talk, it seems they do not see their own differences. One sees you, however, beckoning with a large clawed hand. Approach the creatures, turn down the road, or the next junction... I guess we'll approach. Hope I'm not for dinner. You clamber over the fence and stride toward the creatures. Within a few paces, the smell of cooking meat reaches your nostrils, and you see a large pig turning on a spit above a fire. The creature who waved to you has watched you approach. He grins hooked teeth and cocks his head at you in greeting. Perhaps using magic might give you the advantage? Telepathy? That's a hint. That's definitely a hint. Otherwise I'd greet them. I wouldn't draw my sword and be like, "That's my mother you have on that spit!" And let me cast a spell then, I guess. See if telepathy is available. And it is not. My little cheat sheet here of all my spells. Detect trap, S-U-S. The other one is safest escape. So let's do S-U-S. Sense danger. My spider sense is tingling. You cast a spell and a calm voice enters your mind. It tells you that the creatures nearby are friendly enough, though they will retaliate if crossed, and that the meat is fine and good. Once you are reassured, the voice departs. Greet the creatures. Didn't I already have 14? It didn't take my stamina. Unless I had 15. I was mistaken then. Greetings, you call. That smells good. It is, the creature agrees. We picked the best one to bite into. He waves at you to sit down. Then you understand his generosity. They're poachers. The pig fat sizzles invitingly. I'm going to sit with them. You take a place in a circle around the fire. The creatures shuffle and shift to make room for you. I don't have any money. Ask them about the North Gate. I'm headed for the North Gate, you tell them. Can you help me find my way? The lead poacher looks at you with interest. You're going out into the backlands? Why there? I am on a quest, you reply, trusting that these ruffians are lowly enough not to be in the Archmage's pay. The lead poacher nods, accepting your answer. The North Gate is a hard thing to open, he says. I have never heard of anyone doing it. The spell lines? He nods seriously. Do you know any of the lines? No, the poacher laughs. We do not even know our own names half the time. Who could I ask about the lines? Lorag the Scholar, one says. You should track him down.
Done that.
The other's not in agreement. He's a miserable cur, he adds, but he knows everything there is to know. Was a noble once himself, you know.
Just want to see what they say. Where does Lorag live?
The poachers confer among themselves in a curt tongue you do not recognize. Then they seem to agree. Over the river, the leader says. They say he has a house just on the edge of the Red Quarter. But if you go that way, then... Esh. He makes a curious sucking noise through his teeth. You'd better keep your eyes open. Or rather, closed. From across the field, a woman begins to sing. The poachers smile and clap each other on the back. Sorcery is coming. You talk to her.
Who is Sorcery?
Sorcery is our treasure, the man says. Sorcery is how we know what we should do. You'll see. By now the woman has reached the group. She greets the men with a kiss on either cheek. You notice she is carrying something carefully in a cloth. The man beside you beckons her to sit down beside him. This is our visitor. Greetings, Sorcery says. What can I help you with?
I need to open the north gate.
She smiles. Tricky. Very tricky. As she speaks, she squats down on her heels and places a cloth on the ground. Unwrapping it slowly, she reveals an orb of crystal.
I'm not going to try to steal the orb with all these guys here. Are you kidding me?
You're a fortune teller? Sorcery sees all, one of the poachers calls out. For instance, which fields will be left untended, says another, with a hearty laugh.
I can't pay you. Persuade another to have their fortune told.
You look around the group for one who seems most uncertain, unsure of himself. You, why don't you hear your fortune? He looks uncomfortable, but Sorcery grins, and the others insist. Go on, let's hear it. Maybe you'll be getting married this decade. He sits opposite her on the mud. She places her palms on the crystal and begins to hum. It doesn't look like any fortune-telling spell you have ever read about. Wait and watch. A minute passes, and then Cersei's eyes flick open. I see a long journey, she says to the man, to a distant land. I see danger and excitement. Keep watching. You keep your eyes fixed on her closed eyelids as she talks, trying to catch the reflection of any stars. I see more. You must watch for a dagger and a fish. I see a road paved with white stone leading to a place of great sadness, a blind man who will stab you in the back. She lifts her palm from the glass and smiles. Someone gets her some pork to eat.
Offer to read her fortune?
Let me try reading your fortune, you declare into the quiet that follows her reading. You tell everyone else's. You must be curious about your own. Cersei stops eating to stare at you. There is a murmur of excitement from the group. This is a most unusual challenge. You? She demands. And what do you know of fortune-telling?
This thing. I don't want to get them... Like, I don't want to piss them off or anything. They will retaliate if crossed. If I, like, insult her in some way, they obviously think very highly of her. That wouldn't be a good idea. I am a sorcerer.
She raises a thin, dark eyebrow in cool surprise. Are you? You hold out a hand for the crystal orb. Not taking her eyes off you, she puts it into your hand. Then she sits defiantly down in front of you. Well then, tell me what you see for poor old Cersei, she declares, her eyes flashing with the challenge. You take a moment to collect your thoughts. The orb is pleasingly heavy in your palm. Now...
I see the spell. FARC future requires crystal orb. Done. It's in the spell book. It's right there. Wait. Wait, that's an F. That's a weird F. But it's an F nonetheless.
You cast a spell, placing your hands on the crystal orb, and it's not taking any stamina, you notice that. Well, that one didn't say it required stamina. Your mind clears, and a vision forms, but it is not of Cersei and her future, but your own. You see yourself in a low stone shrine somewhere here in the city of Kharé. A man in a long white robe stands at your elbow. He is speaking,
What is the answer to the question that has never been asked? Is that Lorag? You see your own mouth opening to reply. You concentrate as hard as you can, struggling to maintain the vision. Then, as it begins to slip, there's a touch on your hand. Another presence joins yours. Sorcery? You breathe. In your vision, you see the man in the white robe bow his head, defeated at the word. The vision fades. Sorcery is watching you intently, wanting to hear her fortune. The crowd around lean eagerly in. I see your fortune. You begin. I gotta make it up? It tell my own fortune. Is this my fortune? I'm in a low stone shrine here in Kharé. A man in a white robe. What is the answer to the question that has never been asked? I see you telling great fortunes, I guess. You say, and you see her smile perk up. Is that all? She asks nervously. I see you... I don't want to be obvious. I don't want to insult her or get them pissed off at me. I see you divulging a secret. You continue. Cerise looks stunned by your words. She clearly believes you a true psychic. Why does all of a sudden she believe me a true psychic? She was so, like, ready for this challenge and... I guess, I don't know. A great and weighty decision seems to pass across her face. She looks to you for a moment to confirm it, then nods once more and turns to her friends. Please be quiet, all of you, she says quietly. The stranger is right, and I must make a confession. Wait and watch. I have told great fortunes, good ones, she continues sadly, but not true ones. That's my secret. The poachers cannot believe their ears. One denies it. Another claims to have known it all along. A third, who it seems lost a lot of money on a bet once, becomes quite enraged and is held back by two more. Within a few moments, the whole group are rolling around in the mud, engaged in the most almighty punch-up. I don't want to just steal the orb. It's a messy fight. You wade in, trying to hold the poachers apart and keep the men from throwing each other into the fire, but there is nothing you can do to keep them apart. A moment later, someone snatches the orb from your hands and cracks it over another man's head. Great. You crawl out from under a pile of bodies and hurry back to the safety of the road. I've found a new clue, though. Which is what? In a vision, you saw the answer to the question that has never been asked. Sorcery. So, Sorcery is the answer. So, what's the question? Downhill? Uphill? He's supposed to be around here in Lower Kharé, so let's go downhill. Still looking for Moulas. You continue down the road, heading back towards the wall, just visible in the distance. A few buildings appear on the right-hand side of the road. It is quiet, with no one about. You pass by a large structure with its doors open wide. The smell of incense floats out from within. Look at the building. You stop and peer inside, but make out nothing but darkness. It seems to be a wide, unlit space. The low sound of chanting floats out into the street. A woman's voice. I'm just going to walk on in, I guess. You step into the gloomy shade of the building. The aroma of perfume and oil grows so thick that you begin to cough and choke, announcing your presence to whoever is inside. The singing voice falls silent. Who's there? You call out to the darkness. There is no reply, just a quiet sound, like a light footstep or the turning page of a book. Then there is a voice. Greetings, woman of Annaland. I see you are an honorable soul. You are welcome. Greetings, you answer. The voice laughs, a gentle, pealing sound like a chime. I see you are searching for something.
I am after the North Gate spell.
You reply. Is that so?
That is forbidden knowledge.
The voice laughs again. There is that noise again, like a palm slapping down. I see difficulty upon difficulty.
Can you help?
Another slap. It is the sound of a card being turned from a deck.
Tell me,
she says. Speak a word, and I will tell you what I see.
So we're getting our fortune told again.
Gate.
I see a closed door. I see a whispered secret. I see a trap of fire.
Fire.
Trap of fire, huh? I don't know. Magic.
I see a dead end, a closed door. I see a wise man, but the card is reversed. This means death. I see a snake that eats its own tail.
Lorak?
My death?
Noble.
I see a grave. I see a ghost who walks. I see a wise man. Suddenly, from the far end of the room, a single candle flame ignites. A shade has been lifted from a lamp, revealing a woman in a deep hood, seated at a star-shaped table. She is staring at the cards laid out in front of her.
Look at the cards.
Through the gloom, you can make out very little of them. You seek the crown of kings, the woman gasps suddenly. You intend to conquer the old world.
What is the crown?
You ask, what is it? What is its power? She stares at you. You seek it, but you do not know? The crown carries the power to bend a will, to make another believe. It would be better if the crown were dropped into the sea. Remember this.
Who are you?
You ask, stepping forward. The woman looks up with deep eyes. A long scar runs across her face, from mouth to left ear. I see things, she says. Things that not all wish to hear.
Given a lot of chances to be rude here.
I wish to hear. She nods. You are wise. She turns another card, of movement that is almost involuntary. Then she looks up at you. Remember this. The crown is not in Kharé, but there are many who claim it is, and only one who is deceived. Only one truly believes.
Yeah, no, it's not in Kharé. We have two more chapters to get through.
Thank you. You thank her for her mysterious warning, but her attention is lost once more, taken by the cracks in the flagstone floor on which she sits. The streets will burn, she murmurs. The wolves must be turned around.
Yeah.
Vic for First Noble. You leave her to her dark vision. You step back out onto the path to continue your journey.
Still looking for Moulas. We can't go that way now.
Turn back down the road. You stay on the main road, which heads down a slight slope to reach a small settlement of poor huts. As you pass these homes, ugly creatures gather to watch you in silence. A little further on, you come across a body laying face down in the gutter, a beggar, asleep or some sort of creature in a drunken stupor.
Check to see if the creature is alive.
You approach the limp body cautiously. Nobody in the street seems to be taking any notice. You bend down closer and shake the shoulder of the body. There is no response.
Roll it over.
Okay, we're in trouble. You grip the body's arm and turn it over. As its face swings around, you jump back, aghast. The body is a semi-decayed corpse, with a rotting head that is half-skull, half-putrid flesh, and worse, an evil smile is spreading across its face. A moment later it has sprung to its feet, leaping at you.
Moulas, I presume?
Undead guy?
Spells. Well, I don't have my silver bolt crossbow anymore. Or silver arrow crossbow, unfortunately.
We can cast Wall, which is invisible wall. We can go Walk, which is... What the hell is Walk? We'll cook him up some noodles. Metal Shield, which requires a gold piece, so I can't do that. P.O. These are P's? But that looks different than the other P. Pop? What's pop? Hold on a second, guys. Looking for pop. Oh. Exploding pebbles. Requires a pebble. I don't know if I have a pebble. If I did, I mean, how... How useful is that going to be? I did the W's, right? And R. We got Wrap. Start wrapping. Wrap. It's probably a communicate with someone spell. Speak with person. Why would I choose that? Or RES, which is resurrection. Requires holy water. Imagine that if I resurrected him into living form. That would be freaking amazing. But I don't have holy water. I am pretty damn sure I do not have holy water. Nope. That'd be so cool if I did, right? I'm gonna make invisible wall then. Yeah, I'm pretty sure I looked at all of them. So, W-A-L. Unfortunately, it requires 3 stamina. This time it took it. You cast a spell and an invisible wall forms in the air between you and the corpse. The creature throws itself against the wall, smashing itself into pieces as it tries to get to you. But then pieces float up and over the wall and come at you again. What? These pieces are all hanging around? You draw your sword and inflict a quick blow. The blade lands deeper than you expect, slicing the corpse right down the middle. It collapses into a bloody mess of arms, legs, and head. But a moment later, the parts have been lifted from the ground to surround you, clawing, biting, kicking, and shoving. How do we fight this? Do we have any... Let me see if there's any spells added. Oh, there's H now. It's gonna be Fireball. Yeah, that's hot as Fireball. Gum is a web spell. Catch the pieces in a web. Oh. I don't have a vial of glue. Six. What's six? Checking. Mirror image? I haven't used that yet. Mirror image. Interesting though. Pop again. Fog, darkness. Let's try mirror image, I guess. Clone the caster. I guess that helped. You cast a spell creating 5 clones of yourself who fan out to stand on either side of you. Without the need for agreement, each tackles a different piece of the corpse. The battle is finished in 6 single strokes. Oh, what a coincidence. The body parts on the ground squirm and slowly ooze back together. The corpse now looks once again as though it has been run over in a chariot race, but it is definitely lying still, for now at least. Moulas, search the body. Expecting another immediate attack, you go over to search the body, but it is clothed in rags and has barely any pockets, let alone anything inside them. And this throat? Belt? You unstrap the corpse's rotten belt to see if anything is to see if it has anything secured underneath it. Nothing. From a nearby doorway, a face appears and beckons you over. But I'm trying to look at the what? Are you the fortune teller? You stride over to the hut. The face is that of a small gnome. It begins to chatter in a high-pitched voice. You killed it! Did you kill it? I think you killed it! It was dead before. You tell the gnome, it may not be dead now. Oh no, you've definitely killed it, the gnome replies, shaking his head. I'll be a good few months before it wakes up again. We'll cart it somewhere else. Here, we wanted to thank you. He reaches behind him for something. Wait to see what he does. Oh, we got 5 gold. You wait and the gnome produces a small bag containing 5 gold pieces. I'm sure it's not much to a woman like you, he apologizes, but it's from all of us. Peering through the window of the tiny hut, you make out 20 or so faces. Thank you, you reply and nod your head. What was that creature? They say it used to be the second noble of Kharé, the gnome whispers, but he angered the first, so he was cursed to live in Kharé forever. Now he's like a bad gold piece, keeps showing up. He gets dumped in different parts of the city. I think we'll take him to the Sfin quarter next. It's there to turn. There's a chuckle of agreement from inside the house. Ask about the spell lines. Now maybe you can help me. Do you know anything of the spells for the North Gate? You ask. The gnome bursts into laughter, laughing so hard, in fact, that he begins to cry. Do I look like a knob? He asks. Do I? I guess this is the least insulting. You look like your ear is near the ground. You reply. The gnome nods at that. True, true. But to know the lines, you have to go deeper than that. Not all the nobles are even alive anymore. He scratches his nose meaningfully, although what he means is anyone's guess. Anyway, you should ask the priest at the shrine. He might be able to help. The gnome is starting to look awkward. What priest? The priest, the gnome shrieks, alarmed by your sharp response. He waggles a nervous nose up the road somewhere. And then near the docks. Well, I need a drink, guys. The gnome's nose twitches. I'm going now, he says quickly. Here's one more gift. There's more kerfuffle, and he brings out a small purple potion. Blimberry juice, he says. You're bound to get some scrapes along the way. He presses the potion into your hand. You thank him and place the gift carefully into your pack. You continue downhill until you find yourself back at the place where the road splits. Your clues have been updated. Well, wait. That's Moulas. Damn it. I need his spell line. Some clue have been updated. I don't know which one, though. That's the last thing we need, guys, is that. I'm gonna go back. No. Wait, cancel. Turn down the road. Alright. I mean, maybe if I check in its friggin' throat. What if I try to talk to him? Right? Which one was it? Oh, I need a green-haired wig to speak with person. Damn it. I'll just do what I did last time. Can I just go 6 now? 6. Mm-hmm. Wow, we have more stamina than we did last time. Now I'm starting to stutter like the gnome. Search the corpse's mouth. You open the corpse's mouth with one finger and look inside. Nothing there. But then you remember the corpse's strange guttural screams as though he were constantly choking. Look in his throat. Disgusted, you push your fingers back into the back of the corpse's throat. Something? Yes. With fingertips you draw out a fragment of paper. It is a handwritten line, but has been torn in half, along with the script, and you cannot make out the words. Oh, I'm definitely keeping the note. You pocket the strange note. Perhaps you will discover what it means. From the nearby doorway, a face appears and beckons you over. Blah, blah, blah. I need... Is it a clue? A key? Paper fragment. The fragment has been torn through it. That music is way too loud. The fragment has been torn through and cannot be read. Damn it. Alright, we'll get our stuff from this guy. I'm just gonna choose all the same things. 5 gold pieces. What was the creature? Spell lines. Ear near ground. What priest? Clues have been updated. Okay. So, is this his spell line? Damn it. How do I read it? At least now we have 5 gold. This is the first junction you saw this morning. You have spent half the day walking in circles, and soon it will be evening. At least you have uncovered some of the spell lines. You need somewhere to stay before it gets dark. You turn to face back up the hill once more. Well, I don't know where we could stay over here. This is the Festival of Thieves, and now that we have gold, they're going to steal our gold. If I get more gold stolen, guys, I'm gonna rewind it. Have you seen this? You head right along a wide track until you reach a large hut. It is the only building on this path that is still standing. Either side are empty plots, once the houses of the farmers who planted the fields to the north. They are now collapsed and thick with gripweed. It seems here, in the shadow of the city wall, is not a place people choose to live. We never figured this out. We never went in here, did we? By the side of the door of the hut is a sign, delicately painted, Chainmaker. The door is just a crack ajar, and from within you hear a gentle tinkling sound, metal on metal, as though a creature in a chainmail dress was endlessly pacing the floor. You pause for a moment longer and listen closely at the door, but there are no voices or footsteps from within, just the sound of chains. From further on comes the falling and rising sound of a crowd. Some kind of event is taking place. There are several places you could go next. I don't want to rewind. I want to go here. You push open the hut door and enter. It is dark inside. The floor is sawdust, and the air smells of oil, polish, and burnt metal. From the ceiling, hanging like ivy, are metal chains of all lengths and thickness, some suitable for machinery, some for oxen, and others for arms and feet. The chains shift and whisper to themselves. There seems to be no one here. There's another room beyond. Its door is hanging open. No shop owner in Kharé should leave their wares unattended. You begin to carefully search the room, trying not to set the chains to rattling. What am I looking for? Look under the table. You start your search under the work table, but there is nothing but dust and wood ticks there. Next, you look near the left wall and come across a small box containing 3 gold pieces, which you take. Okay, I just took them. I wasn't asked if I wanted to do that. Right wall. Okay, I took that too. A high cupboard is fixed to the right-hand wall. Inside, you find a glass container labeled in the same hand as a shop sign, Blimberry Juice, which you take, so you now have 2 lots of the potion. That's right, he gave me Blimberry Juice. 2 doses. Searching around near the door to the shop, you find a small vial of glue, used by the chainmaker to hold together his more delicate and cheaper chains. You take it. Why am I just taking this? And we've turned to ape. You notice? Because I'm stealing things. Good thing I'm not under Kharé now. He'd be very angry with me. The glue is for the web spell. Oh, it basically works like a web spell. Gum spell. You cross the room to search the other end of the room, moving as quietly as you can. But halfway over, a chain-linked net drops from the ceiling and knocks you to the ground with a tremendous clatter. You have triggered a trap. There's a shuffling in the back room. Someone is coming. Cast a spell? Of what? How to get out of the trap. Well, we're in an enclosed space. Giant form may hurt me. I mean, how tough is this hut, right? I could do HOW for safest escape, if available. Darkness? That's an interesting idea. Well, if I wait till he gets to me, then I can cast the gum spell at him. Now that we have the glue. Actually have gold now, which is nice. I guess the game figured, you know, what sense is there, you know, trying to look for something if you're not gonna take it. I have a bracelet. Do I have the bracelet of bone? No. I lost that. I would only cast darkness. I'm not sure what good it'll do. I'm still stuck in a net. We have HOW available, which is the safest escape from trap. We have Yob, which is summon giant. But we're in a hut, right? So, we also have Y, A, Z? Or Yap or Yaz? Yap is... Yaz... Oh. I need a pearl ring. I don't have a pearl ring. And Yap is talking, right? Communication? Speak with animal. I don't have a pearl ring. Cue the loud music. What's that? No. Pep? They give me like added strength or something. I see pop. Pep is super strength, requires fire water. I don't think I have fire water. I should write down here on the other side what the things I have. What items. Also have F-A-L? Featherfall? Featherfall? I'm on the ground. Unless the net's still falling? It already dropped from the ceiling. So... Sorry guys, I'm deliberating so long. Darkness is not available. That's fog. Yeah, so I'm gonna wait to see who comes. There's no use fighting with the heavy chains. You wait. A shadow appears in a doorway. It is a chainmaker, a great hulk of a sphin, like those you met in the village of Torapani. He whips away the net. Intruder, eh? The chainmaker growls fiercely and snatches up a particularly heavy length of metal, holding it like it was thread. Let's see what spells are available. Fireball we have. Raz. Requires beeswax. Beeswax. So we don't have that. Mud? Quicksand. Could work. I wouldn't cast fireball in this hut. It would probably damage me as well, so that's that. We have quicksand. And let me just see our options here. Fireball. F-I. Mirror image. Oh no, fix. Well, that's six is mirror image. What's fix? Fix. Fix. Hold animate or inanimate object. Staff of oak sapling. I don't have that, right? I have a staff, but it's not a staff of oak, right? No, it's a walking cane. Besides, it would appear under magical items. Raz, we see. That's it. Okay, so these are our options, guys. This is an hour long, sorry. You know, I should have stopped at the 27-minute mark with that choice. But, yeah. I didn't, so here we are. Three choices. Fight him, talk my way out of it, or cast a quicksand spell at him. Oh, wait. I can't. It requires sand. I don't have sand. Nope. Okay, well, I could try fireball. If this place is big enough inside, maybe it won't kill me. So, okay, three options. Fight him, talk my way out of it, or cast fireball at him. Which hopefully I can do through the net, and hopefully will not injure me as well. So those are our three options, guys. Fight, talk, fireball. Put your options down below, of course, and let me know what you think, and I hope to see you in the next episode. Thanks so much for voting and for watching, and see you next week, guys. Endure. In enduring, grow strong.